and I'm responsible for what happens here.
And Facebook boss Mark Zuckerberg gears up for more questioning on Capitol Hill just hours from now. Good morning and welcome to Early Start. I'm Alex Marquardt.
Nice to see you again this morning. And I'm Christine Romans. It is Wednesday, April 11th. It is 4 a.m. in the East, 11 a.m. in Beirut and Moscow. Stories from those cities shortly. But first, we begin here. Sources familiar with discussions in the White House tell CNN it looks like President Trump is considering firing Deputy Attorney General Rod Rosenstein in the wake of the FBI raid on Trump fixer and personal attorney Michael Cohen. Rosenstein has been supervising special counsel Robert Mueller's Russia investigation since Attorney General Jeff Sessions recused himself. The president has talked about firing all three men, Sessions, Rosenstein, and Mueller, at various points. The widespread assumption was that federal regulations barred President Trump from firing Mueller directly. But yesterday we learned the president does not share that assumption. Listen.
Does the president believe he has the power to fire Special Counsel Robert Mueller? Does he believe that's within his power?
Certainly believes he has the power to do so.
Now, Press Secretary Sarah Sanders did not suggest that President Trump is, in fact, planning to fire Mueller. But CNN has learned that the president has been talking about it for months. We know that he made moves to fire Mueller last June, but was then talked out of it. And just yesterday, the New York Times reported that there was a second aborted effort to fire the special counsel in December. That move fueled by reports that Mueller had issued subpoenas to Deutsche Bank, the president's financial records, reports which proved to be inaccurate. For more on the latest developments, let's go to the White House and CNN's Pamela Brown.
Well, good morning, Christine and Alex. Our team has learned the president's consideration of firing Rod Rosenstein has gained urgency following the raid of the office of the president's personal lawyer, Michael Cohen. Sources familiar with the matter say this is one of several options, including going so far as to fire Attorney General Jeff Sessions as well, that Trump has been weighing. And officials say if Trump acts, Rosenstein is his most likely target because installing a new deputy attorney general could provide the check on Mueller that Trump has been seeking. We should note not all of Trump's legal advisors are on board with this, but others are telling him that they now believe they have a stronger case against Rosenstein. They believe he has crossed the line and what he can and cannot pursue, and they consider him conflicted since he is a potential witness in the special counsel's investigation because he wrote the memo that justified firing former FBI Director James Comey. So even though Trump has considered firing Rosenstein in the past, the possibility has taken on a more serious tone in recent days, according to sources we've spoken with. Christine and Alex.
All right. Thanks, Pamela Brown. Now, top Republicans in the Senate are urging President Trump not to fire Mueller. They want the special counsel to finish what he started. And they are warning Mr. Trump that his presidency could be on the line.
I think it would be suicide for the president to fire him. I think the less the president says about this whole thing, the better off he will be.
My advice to anybody would let Director Mueller do his job. It would be a mistake to fire him, so I don't think his job is in jeopardy.
I do think it's important we continue with the investigation.
And I think it's in his best interest if he does not.
The best thing that could happen for the president and the country is for Mueller to be able to finish his work.
All right, following the raid on Michael Cohen, the president's legal team is reevaluating whether Mr. Trump should agree to an interview with the special counsel. One White House official telling CNN the president's cooperation should be proportional to the courtesy he receives from Robert Mueller. And the administration believes the Cohen raid showed a lack of courtesy. CNN has also learned Mueller's investigators were meeting with the president's lawyers on the same day the FBI raided Cohen.
And Cohen tells the FBI that the FBI was extremely courteous, professional, and respectful while raiding his home, his office, and his hotel room. That directly contradicts what the president described as a break-in. Cohen says he is upset about being targeted, but actually thanked the agents when they were done. When he asked if he was worried, Cohen told CNN, quote, "I'd be lying to you if I told you that I'm not. Do I need this in my life? No. Do I want to be involved in this? No."
Right, a source familiar with the raid on the New York City hotel room where Cohen and his wife were staying says Cohen answered the door himself early Monday morning. An FBI agent immediately stuck his foot in the door so Cohen could not close it and took Cohen's cell phone right out of his hand. Sources say that among the items agents were looking for in the raids on Cohen's hotel room, his home, and his office were records of payments to women who allegedly had affairs with Mr. Trump, Stormy Daniels and Karen McDougal. The search warrants are also said to cover Cohen's business investments and material related to election laws.
Before the search warrants were issued for the Michael Cohen raid, Manhattan's top federal prosecutor recused himself from the case. Attorney General Jeff Sessions had appointed Jeffrey Berman in January on just an interim basis. But it's not clear why Berman chose to step aside now. But we do know that his decision was approved by senior Justice Department officials.
Stormy Daniels is cooperating with federal investigators, a fact confirmed by her lawyer, Michael Avenatti, on the heels of the Michael Cohen raid. Sources tell CNN investigators are looking into the non-disclosure agreement and subsequent payment made to her by Cohen, the president's personal attorney. A source tells CNN the federal probe is extensive and aggressive, and a large team is working on this case. Stormy Daniels is set to appear on the next cover of Penthouse magazine, featuring a profile about her and her alleged affair with Mr. Trump.
All right, well, turning overseas, President Trump is canceling a trip to South America this weekend. The White House says he wants to remain in Washington to deal with the chemical attack in Syria. On Tuesday, the president spoke by phone with British Prime Minister Theresa May and French President Emmanuel Macron about a strong joint response from the West, all while Russia was vetoing a U.S. resolution at the, a U.N. resolution at the Security Council that called for an independent investigation into the attack.
When the people of Douma, along with the rest of the international community, looked to this council to act, one country stood in the way. History will record that. History will record that on this day, Russia chose protecting a monster over the lives of the Syrian people.
Let's now bring in CNN international correspondent Ben Wiedemann, who's tracking the latest developments from Beirut. Ben, we heard just there that Russia at the Security Council vetoed an investigation into this chemical attack. So at this point, it's really just a question of will they, won't they, in terms of a U.S. strike or a U.S.-led strike, isn't it?
Well, Alex, it's actually more like when rather than will they, won't they at this point. Certainly all signals coming from the United States and to a certain extent Paris and London as well is that there will be a strike at some point. And of course, what we heard here in Lebanon is the Russian ambassador in an interview with El Manar television, the television station of Hezbollah, warned that Russian forces will shoot down any missiles fired at Syria. And then he went on to say, and also the source of those missiles. So certainly it appears that the Russians as well are bracing for a possible U.S.-led airstrike or missile strikes on Syria. Now, what's interesting is that last year, when the United States launched cruise missiles on Syria after an alleged missile, chemical strike on a town named Khan Sheikhoun, south of Aleppo, the Americans informed the Russians in advance of the strike. In this case, we don't know if that sort of warning messages are going back and forth, and certainly the Russian ambassador's comments would indicate that that is not the case, that Russian-American relations in the last year seem to have plummeted to a point where we are at a very dangerous situation.
So then the question, of course, would be what kind of strike would it be? Would it be a so-called pinprick strike on a military base, or would it be on something like command and control structures in downtown Damascus? Lots of big questions this morning. Ben Wiedemann in Beirut, thank you very much.
All right, brand new National Security Advisor John Bolton is wasting no time reshaping his White House team. The West Wing announcing Homeland Security Advisor Tom Bossert's departure on Bolton's second day in office. Two sources say Bolton was behind the departure. The sources say Bolton did not have a personal problem with Bossert, but he wants to put his own team in place, his own people in place. So far, Bolton has not announced any new hires on the National Security Council.
Now, this is interesting. The president's nominee for Secretary of State is working behind the scenes to win support from moderate Democrats. Republican Mike Pompeo, who's currently the director of the CIA, is scheduled to appear before the Senate Foreign Relations Committee on Thursday. He's already lost the backing of one Republican in Senator Rand Paul. That means he needs at least one Democratic vote to get the committee's approval. Pompeo, who once called Hillary Clinton morally reprehensible for her response to the 2012 Benghazi attack, is now calling the former Secretary of State for her advice. We're told that Secretary Clinton has been willing to help.
Yeah, we're told he called reached out to all of the living former secretaries of state for their advice, for their guidance on the job that he hopes to take, of course, and that she is being helpful.
A small and exclusive fraternity, so
yeah,
why not?
Yeah, it is. All right, Facebook CEO Mark Zuckerberg facing tough questions on Capitol Hill for failing to protect user data. Nearly half the Senate grilled Zuckerberg for 5 hours yesterday. You know, the verdict here is he emerged relatively unscathed, in part because the large number of questioners left little time for follow-up. Zuckerberg began the hearing by formally apologizing for the host of issues plaguing Facebook.
But it's clear now that we didn't do enough to prevent these tools from being used for harm as well. And that goes for fake news, for foreign interference in elections and hate speech, as well as developers and data privacy.
Last month, it was revealed that a firm with ties to President Trump's campaign accessed the data of 87 million users without their consent. That angered users, advertisers, lawmakers, already struggling with Facebook's role in spreading all this misinformation and allowing election meddling. But while Zuckerberg said he was open to regulation, he deflected questions about specifics, telling lawmakers this.
Yes, and I'll have my team follow up with you so that way we can have this discussion across the different categories where I think that this discussion needs to happen.
Look forward to it.
Wall Street liked that answer, and Wall Street liked Zuckerberg's testimony. Facebook shares rose 4.5% yesterday, its highest level in almost 3 weeks. Facebook has lost, of course, tens of millions in market value since the current crisis began. Zuckerberg testifies again today before the House Energy and Commerce Committee.
And a rising tide lifts all boats. It was not just Facebook stock up, but tech stock across the board.
And it was because the Chinese president, Xi, sort of emerged as the protector of global trade. And Wall Street liked that.
The belt in the room.
Yep.
All right. Well, Bill Cosby's defense team is playing hardball with one of his accusers. You'll hear him say the suspect is 28-year-old Anthony Burgos, and he was in a relationship with a woman. He called 911 on Monday, claiming to have discovered the bodies just feet from the Texas-Mexico border. He then posed as a first responder, canvassing the scene with other law enforcement officials. Authorities say they identified Burgos as a person of interest within an hour of that 911 call.
Miami Beach police say the four men who attacked a gay couple in this surveillance video have turned themselves in and will likely face felony charges. The couple beaten and verbally attacked hours after the city's annual gay pride parade Sunday. Police say a man standing nearby jumped in to help the couple, and then he was hit by one of the attackers and knocked unconscious when his head hit the pavement. All three suffered minor injuries but are said to be okay now.
And Bill Cosby's defense team is now attacking the reputation of the entertainer's accuser, describing Andrea Constant as a so-called victim and a con artist who's after Cosby's money. The aggressive defense comes one day after the prosecution called another woman to the stand who testified that Cosby sexually assaulted her 34 years ago. We now get more from CNN's Jean Casares.
Christine and Alex, cross-examination will continue this morning for the first prior bad act witness, the woman who says Bill Cosby drugged and assaulted me too. Her name is Heidi Thomas. She is out of Colorado, and she testified to the jury that when she was in her early 20s, her acting agency out of Denver called her up and said a major celebrity wants to mentor you. Didn't say his name. Days later, Bill Cosby called her on the phone. He spoke with her father and then her mother. He said, I want to help you in the business. She was on a plane to Reno, Nevada because he was performing at Harrah's. She thought she was going to stay at the hotel, but a driver picked her up, and she testified that she drove 15 or 20 minutes outside of Reno to a ranch-style home where Cosby opened the door. He ensued giving her acting lessons, but then it became a lot more. Heidi said she never wanted to go public, and she didn't, but she finally opened up. I flew to Colorado last year to talk with her.
Would you say the assault would have been at this home?
I know the assault was at the house. At least the one I remember. I don't even know if there was more than one. But I remember one, and it was at the house.
And you woke up in his bedroom?
Uh-huh.
In his bed?
Mm-hmm.
And there he was?
Yeah, he was naked. I was clothed.
The cross-examination will continue this morning with Heidi Thomas. We don't know exactly where the defense is going at this point, but they definitely will not want the jury to believe her story. Christine, Alex.
All right, Jean will follow that for us today. Thank you, Jean. Now, the school board in Broward County, Florida, where a gunman killed 17 students and staff members at Stoneman Douglas High School, that school board has voted against arming teachers Instead, school officials say funding should be allocated to a program to hire more school resource officers. Last month, Governor Rick Scott signed a controversial bill tightening gun control in several ways while also allowing some teachers to be armed. It was the first gun control legislation enacted in the state after the Parkland school massacre last February. You know, some school boards have been looking into this, and there's an insurance problem. Getting insurance in your school board, if you are in your school district, if you are going to insure your teachers and insure your property if you have armed teachers.
I keep coming back to the fact that we know that the percentage of shooting accuracy among people, police officers who are highly trained, is extremely low, around 20%. And so you can imagine it'll only be lower among less trained, far less trained teachers.
Yeah, who have a lot of other things they're trying to do.
Much different priorities,
right,
shall we say. All right, well, no one is laughing